everyone, it's Becca from Rock You again, doing another voice teacher react video. This time I am reacting to a 1981 Montreal performance of Bohemian Rhapsody by Freddie Mercury and Queen. I want to talk us through just some of Freddie Mercury's techniques, what he's doing, why he's sounding so good, and what kind of strategic choices he's making that are helping support this really great performance for him. So let's go ahead and get started. Right off the bat, before I've even pressed play, we see Freddie Mercury seated at the piano. And this can be kind of a troubling sign for some vocalists. You know, those of us who do know how to play the piano know that we should be seated really tall at the piano, ideally. But that's not always how it goes. Oftentimes we kind of hunch over, and that prevents us from taking and retaining a good breath. So we really want to pay attention to our posture when we are seated at the piano, which we kind of see Freddie Mercury's head a little forward, his shoulders a little rounded. And that's tough because it can really get in the way of our breathing technique. So let's go ahead and start the video, see how he does with this.
She's killed a man, put a gun against his head, pulled my trigger, now he's dead, mama.
Pausing here at 21 seconds, we're noticing that he's not holding out a lot of these phrases as long as he does on the recording. He's kind of cutting it right off, mama, really short. It may have something to do with not being able to get a super deep breath because of the way that he's positioned over the piano. It may have to do with the fact that he's focusing a little on playing the keys well, which we all know that feeling, those of us who do play the keys. Or it could be because he's kind of saving his stamina for the rest of this long song. So it could be any of those things, but we do notice he's pulling off of these phrases a little short.
Life had just begun.
Pausing here at 30 seconds, when we hear him say, now I've gone and thrown it all away, he's really cheating all of these vowels to be super similar. The only exception is in the word thrown. He really kind of closes that O, but he goes, now I've gone and thrown it all away. And so we really have, now I've gone and thrown it all away. So he's really cheating them all towards basically that same ah vowel. And that's important because we want to keep that vowel consistency to make sure that we're able to just keep our vowel right where we want it to be, delivering it into the microphone. And the less we change that vowel, the easier it's going to be to keep that delivery totally consistent. Moving on. Pausing again here at 36 seconds, you can really hear how he moves right from vowel to vowel. He has this beautiful legato line. His breath never stops. His voice never stops. He doesn't let the change of words kind of get in the way of his vocal production. This is really highlighted here when he goes, mama, ooh, moves right from the ah of mama into the ooh, without even lifting, without even pausing. And it doesn't sound weird, even though that might not be how we would speak it, because the sound just continues moving and it allows him to keep his vocal tone really the same, really consistent.
Didn't mean to make you cry. If I'm not back again this time tomorrow, carry on, carry on. There's nothing really.
So here at 49 seconds, he's made the decision not to pop up, carry on, carry on, and instead keeps it low. And I think, you know, that's a stamina decision. And this is why it's really, really important to rehearse a lot before we perform live so we can make these stamina decisions and keep them consistent. So we're not ever guessing or deciding in the moment.
Goodbye, everybody. I've got to go, but I leave you all in
pausing here at 126. Again, he's really delivering this line so consistently, keeping the breath moving and staying that same placement the whole time. You also might notice as he's singing, his lips are almost touching the microphone. And we've seen this a lot in the videos I've been reacting to, pop stars who hold the mic in their hand, kind of really holding the mic like this, very close to their lips. We can really see it in this shot where the mic is held by the mic stand because he's playing piano, but he's really right up in it. His lips are almost touching it, which is why, by the way, I think it's a really good idea if you're playing any venue, bring your own mic. You never know whose lips have been on that. And it's good to have your own. So pausing here at 144, the only time that he really does hold on to the note as long as we expect him to is when he says, "I sometimes wish I'd never been born at all." And you actually notice he takes a breath before saying "born at all." So that has a big impact on why I think he might be cutting these phrases off shorter earlier on, because he's just trying to maintain his stamina. He's just trying to not take breaths in places where they don't make sense. This one he snuck in and it was totally fine because it really kind of allowed him to hold that dramatic note for a little longer, which I think is great. I'm kind of skipping it forward just a little through this kind of instrumental solo portion. Here at 208, we see kind of the lights come down and there is a little bit of a light show going on, but it's actually not clear to me that any of the band is on stage at this point. We see the lights over the drum kit. There's no drummer sitting there. We don't see Freddie Mercury. We kind of hear this song, this portion of the song in the exact same quality as we hear it on the recorded version. And so that makes me think that this is a moment where he's giving the audience a really great light show. They're definitely enjoying it. Everybody knows this song. And kind of the complicated nature of the vocal parts here means it would be really, really hard to perform well. So I think that he's stepped off. He's taking a little break. He's drinking some water, whatever he needs to do. And they're giving this great light show so that people can still enjoy this song that they know so well as he just kind of gets a little break. And so here at 311, the lights come back up after this kind of big like choral section of the song, and all of a sudden the band is back. So that's what makes me think that they took a little break here, which honestly is so smart. If you can find a way in a long set like this, especially one that is so vocal heavy, like anything that Queen would perform, if you can find a moment to step off, drink some water, rest your voice for a moment, that is smart and worth doing. Here we are at 326. So we can see now, especially because he's standing and frankly, because he's not wearing a shirt, we can really in detail see his posture. His back is so straight. His core is super engaged to hold his back so straight. When he does these little dancing moves, they are when he is not singing. And that is really worth noticing. When he's like kind of moving through his spine, anything like that, even sometimes when he's running around, he's not singing during those moments. When he is singing, he's really planted with his feet pretty far apart, giving him a really nice wide base so he can engage his pelvic floor, and with his back pretty straight so that he can really produce these like loud and high vocals that he's achieving here. Moving on. So again, here at 338, we really can notice a couple of things. One, we can really see from this angle how straight his back is. It's so, so clear. And two, I just love watching him perform because he has so much energy in his body. He definitely is acutely aware of each move that he's making, and he's just being like so invigorated by the crowd. But right at 338, where I've paused it, we see exactly what I'm talking about. That wide stance, that tall, straight spine that's really just enabling him to produce these huge, huge sounds. Let's keep going. So I'm pausing right here at 5:05. This is essentially the end of this song. So one thing that I really think is worth noticing too, at the end of this performance, when he transitions from standing to seated, he really is, when he's standing, he is belting, he is loud. You could almost say he's yelling. He has a little bit of grittiness in his voice. When he sits back down, he does not feel the need to do that. He transitions right back into this smooth style of vocal production, quiet, easy on the throat. So he made the decision when he was standing to work a little harder, to sing a little louder, to give a little bit more of a belting sound. But when he sits back down, he immediately gets gentle again. And that's another thing that really indicates to me that he has put so much rehearsal into this performance. He knows exactly how much he can afford to do. And when he sits right back down, he knows exactly how to back off and give his voice some recovery time. So that is my thoughts on the 1981 Montreal performance of Bohemian Rhapsody. Please feel free to like and subscribe and check out my channel linked underneath at Becca Sings. Have a great one. Bye.